Our next speaker today is Stephanie Wang, who has been at Thoughtworks about a year. And one of the themes that happened somewhat organically in this XConf is we've had a number of talks that have explored the intersection of product management and technology. Stephanie is a product manager, but has an interest in technology, has been taking courses on her own time to learn about AR and VR, has built some virtual worlds in the process, and wants to share that learning journey with everybody today. Stephanie, why don't you, welcome to the stage.
Thank you, Brendan. Good morning, afternoon, evening, wherever you are in the world. Welcome to One Beginner's Guide, my guide to XR world building. Who is the beginner in this story? Me, I'm the beginner. What do I know about XR? Not much, honestly. I'm a product manager by day. The products I've worked on fit on the 2D screen, and I have minimal coding experience. However, I'm really excited by the possibilities that XR can bring for the future. I'm a hands-on learner, and I thought the best way to learn about XR world was to build in it. I've been taking courses on the side for about 3 months, give or take. In about 3 months' time, I built an AR app and a VR world. Today, I'm going to share with you what I've learned along the way. If I can do it, you can too. At the end of this talk, I'm going to share a link to my world, and I invite all of you to come and explore with me. What is XR? There are a lot of different definitions out there. This is how I interpret it. XR, or extended reality, is the umbrella term for the different types of realities we can build beyond our reality. We can have a philosophical debate on what is the nature of our reality, but that'll probably take longer than 15 minutes. So let's stick with XR. XR covers, first, AR, augmented reality, where you can overlay a digital object over the real world. For example, you can try on a digital model of a shoe over your IRL in real-life socks. The socks serve as a marker or an image target for your camera. You can have markerless AR as well, where you can scan your environment, and that doesn't require an image target. A popular example of a markerless AR app is Pokemon Go. Next, MR, mixed reality, where the digital object is overlaid on top of the real world, and you can interact with the digital object. For example, surgeons can interact with the digital anatomy model to plan out their surgery. MR, for me, was the hardest one to grasp. This is how I wrapped my head around it. In the digital shoe AR example, you're not interacting with the digital shoe itself. You're interacting with your phone, and your camera detects your socks. If you're able to tie the digital shoes directly, then that would be MR. Lastly, we have VR, virtual reality. VR is where you're fully immersed in the digital world. For example, you can be in the context of a different country to learn a new language. I personally find language learning to be very contextual. My Chinese gets better when I'm in China, and my English actually gets worse. The next time I want to learn a new language, I'll definitely be trying out this VR app. Today, I'm going to be focusing on AR and VR and walk you through an AR app and a VR world I built and share some tips and tricks I learned. So maybe if you want to become a world builder, it'll save you a little time. Let's kick things off with AR. I took a course on Udemy and created an AR book using Unity, a game engine, Vuforia, an AR software development kit, a notebook, and some markers. Remember that AR starts IRL, so like the socks that's targeted to try on the digital shoes, I needed the pictures to target for my book. I tapped into my inner child and started drawing. Eventually, I will overlay 3D objects over 2D images. I was having a great time drawing rainbows, clouds, airplanes, until I ran into a little problem. The first roadblock I faced was this augmentable rating. An augmentable rating is how well an image can be detected and tracked using Vuforia Target Manager. According to Vuforia, my cool, awesome airplane was only rated 2 stars. This meant it was hard to recognize. If I use this version of the airplane as my image target, when I point my camera at it, it's going to be hard to get the digital 3D plane to show up. To make an image more augmentable, Vuforia recommends having sharp edges and better contrast. The goal is to get lots of those yellow crosses on the drawing and to have them more spread out. The yellow crosses represent a feature. The feature is a sharp detail of an image. A square contains four features for each of its corners, and a circle has no features. I went back to the drawing board, literally, my sketchbook. Can you spy the differences between my drawings? I created darker outlines around the airplanes and clouds. I included sharper edges in the bubble letters. I also found better lighting to take my pictures. You can see I have more of those yellow crosses now, and my image is 5 stars. Woohoo! Now that I have the target images, I needed the 3D assets to overlay it. I can make them from scratch, which I did eventually for my VR world. But at this point, I just wanted to see how it would all work together as fast as I could. I discovered this magical place called Unity Asset Store, where you can get 3D assets for free. There are a lot of these libraries out there. Another popular one is TurboSquid. I mapped the 3D assets and 2D target images in Unity, wrote a few lines, only a few lines of C# code for some small animations. And I imported the Unity file into Apple's Xcode so I can have it as an app on my phone to play with. This is how it all came together. I can open the AR app on my phone, point it towards my physical sketchbook, and I'll see on my phone what you're seeing on the screen. I get the augmented 3D version of what I drew. I have my own little AR book. Now let's talk about VR. I built a virtual reality world focused on mindfulness as my final project for a UCLA extension course. I felt the immersiveness of VR creates a great environment for fostering mindful practice. Instead of getting pre-made assets this time, though, I created all of them from scratch using Blender, a free 3D modeling tool. One of the first lessons I learned was you can't actually make anything you want and expect it to work in VR. There's a major technical constraint we have to consider: the number of polygons you can have in a scene. Polygons are the foundational shapes that make up a 3D model. To make a model look more organic, you're going to need more polygons. If you remember the clouds from my AR book, they were low poly. They didn't have as many polygons as these fluffy clouds. They look a little geometric and not as fluffy. I let you think of a number in your head right now on how many triangles do you think it takes to create this cloud. It takes almost 5,000 triangles to make up my fluffy cloud. The platform I used to host my 3D environment, Spatial, which is like Squarespace for VR worlds instead of websites, can handle 200,000 triangles maximum for your entire scene. One cloud is only a small part of my scene. This limit depends on the platform you're using, or if you're making your own VR app, and on your headset's processing power. Meta's Oculus, a consumer-targeted headset, has lower processing power compared to Microsoft's HoloLens, which is more enterprise-focused and can handle more complex scenes. That's also hundreds of dollars for an Oculus compared to thousands of dollars for a HoloLens. If what you build goes beyond what the headset can handle, and you have too many polygons in your environment, your world will be buggy and disorienting. It'd be like inside a static TV, making it hard to visit and not very fun for your visitors. To optimize for performance, textures can come in handy. Textures are 2D images you can wrap around a 3D object. I want to keep my high poly fluffy clouds, so to make the trade-off, I used a grass texture for my ground instead of creating each individual blade of grass in 3D. I still get grass in my environment, but that grass is not going to kill my world. Learning 3D modeling has been one of the most time-consuming parts of my XR world-building journey. I haven't designed anything in 3D before, and you all saw my first grade level drawing skills with the airplane. Although challenging, this is one of the most rewarding parts of the world building experience. It's like taking something from your head and making it real. Once I had a draft of my 3D scene built in Blender, I imported it to Spatial, the VR world hosting platform. Spatial is accessible via both web and headset, making it convenient to test your world. Like any iterative product development process, I did a lot of testing for my world. I had over 20 draft versions. You might be wondering, what should I test in a VR experience? Your world's scale is a good case to test early. How big should your world be in relation to your avatar? Do you want your avatar to feel like King Kong or an ant? Another focus point to test is the ease of navigation. Can your avatar walk on the surfaces you intend them to? I got stuck during one of my tests, literally. You can see my avatar is stuck in the middle of the red cushion. I can tell you I haven't experienced that in 2D product testing before. I also shared drafts of my world with others to get feedback on overall user experience. It's good to test in VR too if you have a headset, since the navigation using hand controls is really different than using a mouse. Don't worry, I debugged my scene and got myself unstuck. This is my world. The intent of my space is to help people start their journey toward inner calm. The centerpiece is an animated flower to direct visitors to pay attention to their breath. The surrounding meditation pods are based on the chakras. The maze at the bottom represents life's chaos and the many paths you can take. Inviting someone into your world feels like giving them a glimpse into your head. I will share the link to the space at the end of this talk. You can just put the link into your browser and you'll be in my world. If you have a headset, I hope you'll visit this in VR. I invite all of you to explore my imagination. During my UCLA class final showcase, my classmates and I visited the world together and they gave me some feedback. They told me it's calming and relaxing. They want to play and play. And someone even told me they wanted to move into my space to live. As a product manager, when your user tells you they want to move into your product, I call that a successful product launch. XR world building is incredibly fun. I learned a lot in the few months I've been playing with it. I learned about image target features, asset libraries, polygon counts, world testing, platforms, and I'm excited to learn more as I dig deeper. I can't be at a Thoughtworks conference, though, for technologists without briefly talking about the tech stack. There are a lot of tools out there. There are 3D asset creation tools we can model directly in VR, like Gravity Sketch and OpenBrush. There are more and more platforms where you can host your world. In addition to Spatial, the one I used, some popular ones are Allspace VR and Meta's Horizon Worlds. For AR, Apple and Google have their AR Kit and AR Core. Snap and Meta have platforms where you can create those fun filters. Niantic's 8th Wall is a web-friendly AR platform. This field is rapidly changing, and this is only a sample of what I've heard of. Out of this toolbox, I've mainly played with these four so far to build my worlds. They don't require any coding, really, and they have free versions, and I hope you'll give them a try. I truly believe that XR can open up endless possibilities for the real world. In the 2021 XR Industry Report, Perkins Coie and XR Association surveyed over 160 industry professionals. They found there is an expected increased usage of immersive technology in many industries besides gaming and entertainment. The survey respondents expect consumers to use immersive technology to buy cars, buy clothes, and to learn. I can attest that having a class in VR is quite fun and engaging. As you saw with my mindful VR world, one of my personal favorite XR applications is using it for well-being. The immersiveness of VR has been used to provide reminiscence therapy, a decade-old therapy practice for seniors at care centers. Studies have shown that visiting the past can cultivate joy and meaning for older adults, improving symptoms of dementia and loneliness. VR makes that reminiscent experience more real. All of a sudden, you're standing in front of the house you haven't been in 50 years. Seniors have been seen to immediately brighten up and become more talkative after the VR visit to their past. As you grow older, your world shrinks. VR can open up your world. I will leave you with some final food for thought. John Riccitiello, the CEO of Unity, said this at the 2022 Augmented World Expo. The next generation of the internet is always real time, mostly 3D, mostly interactive, mostly social, and mostly persistent. Imagine a future where there will be one device, a pair of reading glasses, perhaps, where AR and VR are combined into those glasses. It will replace your phone, your laptop, your TV. The glasses will be mostly AR and can become VR when it needs to be, like if you want to watch an immersive movie or visit your childhood home. The world around you will be your computing connection. You can walk to a wall and interact with it. How would you like to contribute to that world? Thank you.